Hey, good evening, everyone, and welcome to UCL. My name is Felix Ciută. I am a senior lecturer in international politics here at UCL in the School of Slavonic and European Studies. We have a stellar cast for tonight's event, which deals with one question: what is the relationship between video games and democracy? And also deals with, by extension, with two of the burning problems of our day. First is the changing nature of politics and democracy, something that we see expressed not only in elections, but also in recent major decisions that are made in this country, in the UK. And the importance of video games probably doesn't need to be signaled to you. You are here because you're interested in either video games or in democracy, both, and you're curious to know how this relationship will change both democracy, which is quite likely, and video games. But first, let's introduce the panel, so starting here with Cliff.
Okay, I'm Cliff Harris. I'm an indie game developer, so it's basically a tiny little studio that is effectively me. And I made a game called Democracy 3, I made the others as well, obviously, which is a strategy game for the PC where you are basically the president or prime minister. That's me.
Hi, I'm Constance Steinkuhler. I'm a professor at University of Wisconsin-Madison, and I'm a former senior policy analyst for the Obama administration in the White House Office of Science.
Hi, I'm Rob Williams. I'm an aid worker. I run a charity called War Child, whose job is to look after children in conflict zones. So whether that is helping kids escape from rebel groups in Central African Republic or dealing with some very traumatized children who come out from places like Fallujah in northern Iraq after having lived with ISIS. For a couple of years, you will find War Child centers in 12 different conflict zones, from Syria to Afghanistan to the Congo. And we've been using games in a very interesting way, which I'm happy to talk about later.
And I'm Theo Blackwell. I have two hats here. For the last 5 years, I've been head of policy and public affairs at UKI, which represents the video games industry to government on regulatory issues. But also, in my own right, I'm an elected politician in Camden, where we are at the moment. I'm the cabinet member for finance and technology and growth at Camden Town Hall. So I've been working on all sorts of things techie for a number of years.
As you can see, we have guests from different sectors of activity, but all of them are somehow connected, that they have a perspective on this relationship between video games and democracy. The first question that we start with is, how can video games be used in the democratic process? As you see in this image, there is already an extensive history of video games being used politically, either in election campaigns or as recruitment tools, as we have seen with America's Army, or in the mediatic war against Islamic State, where video games imagery, especially from Call of Duty, have been used or invoked by both sides. So the first question is, how are games used in policy by different governments in different countries and probably for different purposes? So let's start with Constance, whose experience in the White House, I think, positions her excellently to start the debate on that particular topic.
Sure. So usually games and democracy are sort of odd bedfellows. And you don't really hear a whole lot of discussion about the intersection. In the last 4 or 5 years, you're hearing more and more, mostly as games have, in the States at least, have come to sort of dwarf Hollywood box office and music industries. The games industry sort of becomes a place where not just politicians, but policymakers and others can think about engaging with the younger generation that has grown up on games. My own work in the White House role, I was literally there for games and games only. And a lot of that work came out of a body of research that we had been doing. I was part of it, looking at what are some of the sort of cognitive intellectual benefits of gaming and thinking about the ways in which games can kind of reorganize civic participation, engagement in STEM and technology fields, literacy practices, et cetera, for young people and adults. So I guess I would argue there's sort of multiple ways in which we could think about how games might play a role in policy. That range from, I mean, some of the work that you do, like how do we represent democracy and democratic processes, or even fundamental concepts and notions around how society works and how governance works in games. And of course, here in the picture that you had is, of course, a political ad in a racing game. So that's kind of a brute force one. But sort of there's you know, from representations of how civic engagement ought to happen or does happen in the context of games, all the way over to thinking about policy and governance as a form of structured interaction. So games as a way to think about how to design those interactions. And in that context, sort of thinking about policy in a very sort of small P way. And by that, I mean policy is something that is the shaping of people and their engagement with government. So in the States, we worked on projects that ranged from, giving good headlines and kudos to, say, iCivics curriculum, which is the biggest games-based curriculum in the States, and that's actually on the political government system. So it ranged from work like that all the way over to thinking about what are some of the game type mechanics that you could use using the smart grid energy system to reduce people's energy consumption if they opt into certain sort of forms of, you know, achievements or game mechanics that try to take a more playful stance toward voluntary participation in kind of behavior change.
Is there any difference between the American context and the British context, given the fact that you've interacted with government as a representative of BKIE, and also you work British politics?
I think, Felix, I think certainly there's no central government unit or advisory to the Prime Minister on video games or role that you had within the Science and Technology Advisory Committee. It certainly wasn't. I mean, the government did quite a lot of stock on technology over the last 5 years. That was kind of quite a hallmark of the kind of coalition government, and the feel of the Cameron government was very much about technology drives reform. But where it stopped, I'm a Labour politician, by the way, but I mean, where it stopped was when it came to citizen participation. So there was the emphasis on technology was much more of a kind of a driver for making the state more efficient, rather than engaging with people.
Okay.
I think that in my area, which is humanitarian aid, the donor countries have a lot to learn from the gaming industry. There are some massive issues which affect refugees. For example, how do you educate 2 million Syrian refugees? We've been using games to teach literacy and numeracy to this generation, which is going to be very challenged by the whole prospect of rebuilding their own country. And donors have been quite slow to see that the challenge of educating so many refugee children can be greatly speeded up if you invest in games-based educational technology. You can't just take American games about literacy and put them in a refugee camp populated by kids who speak Arabic. Our software has kids learning by counting fruits, which you will find in the Middle East, or the pilot was in Sudan, where you had to count baskets of corn, which is what they grow over there. It needs adapting, but the potential in terms of public policy for solving some of the big challenges of the present refugee crisis.
This morning, Constance, you mentioned brilliantly named Federal Games, I think it was working group, or you mentioned that there were something like 33 different agencies.
Yeah, I mean, you know, it's interesting. When I was brought in, and there was no position like that before, and when I first got the call, I actually thought they were joking. I was like, really? Thanks. I thought it was a prank call. and was surprised to find out it was not. But the truth is that, you know, multiple agencies have been in the American government have been funding games, but they're not setting out, you know, like a call for proposals for games. What's happening is that, you know, you have mission-driven agencies like the Department of the Interior trying to get young people to engage in our national park system, right, and use our space. Or over in HHS, Human Health Resources, trying to figure out how do you reduce childhood obesity. Or over in education, using games to teach what you're talking about now to up general numeracy and literacy. And so what had happened was that, you know, over the last 10 years, more and more games became a portfolio of what the government was funding in their agencies because game proposals were coming through, they were getting high ratings, and they were just by accident becoming part of the portfolio of what government was engaging with. And mostly because game-based interventions actually have more than a decade of work across domains showing that, in fact, they're extremely effective as interventions. They also draw a bigger crowd than typical media do for young people. So that was sort of the context I walked in on. And by the time we left, I helped organize and just sort of think about trying to connect and organize the program officers across the agencies that were funding these kinds of projects, because making a game is really hard. And trust me, if you're a government agent, very few of you exist, right? Most of the time they're trying to invest in the most effective intervention they can. Let's say it's for, I don't know, improving science understanding, but they don't know anything about games. So a lot of that work was trying to put them in contact with each other and then connect them to folks like Cliff and others that actually did know something about games. And by the time I left, that organization, that group is still running, but we had a presidential level organization of, say, secretaries in the agencies, which is very high level. And we had a working group of this Games Guild that was, let's see, I think it was like 230 or something, well over 200 when I left. Of program officers that were directly funding games in 33 different agencies and 4 White House groups. So it was pretty extensive. You know, and call it what you will, they'll use language like interactive media in order to not incite a riot about the fact that they're using games. But even things like the State Department in the U.S. is moving toward more digital interactions in order to reach a broader audience.
I mean, here in the UK, I mean, there have been, like, I mean, the BBC, for example, and Channel 4 have commissioned games for social projects, which is a slightly different thing to, you know, civic participation and politics. So, of course, games have been used to enhance the computing curriculum, which went live in 2014. It's been used in public health, for example, to make people aware of, you know, major public health issues, smoking cessation and such like, usually aimed at, rather cunningly, at children in order to tell their parents that what they're doing is bad rather than to engage with the parents themselves. And, of course, on climate change. But it's not been done in such a way as in a joined up, this is a medium which we should use in order to combat these social ills.
Politicians, I think, are scared of games. Generally, in the UK, politicians look upon games as an industry that might create jobs, which, you know, they see as a good thing, or they look upon it as a way they can, like, talk to the kids, because they think only kids play games. But there's still generally, like, kind of prejudice against the whole industry, and you've just reminded me of something I've completely forgotten about when you were talking about like volunteerism and like groups like achieving things. I remember a while ago I was involved in a sale of our games where some of the money goes to charity, and you get to kind of pick what charity you would like that percentage of the money to go to. And we picked a charity that we thought was a sort of like a deserving cause for people in the developing world. And the charity turned us down. The charity actually said, we don't want to be associated with video games.
That wasn't us, right?
No. I was charity because it's a good charity. Yeah. But it is quite shocking that the perception of video games as like doing bad things is enough that they will actually sort of turn away charitable money. So, you know, that's how far we have to go, I guess.
So on the one hand, we have a contradiction between the growing popularity of video games. We heard this morning some numbers from the United States. 99% of children between 12 and 17 are playing video games, and 50% of adults play video games in some form. Which means that video games are, as a vehicle, are an extremely efficient way to reach a particular audience, even though the game itself doesn't matter. So in that paradigm, we can think of video games as just a new technological evolution. There used to be radio, and then there used to be television, and then there used to be internet and social media, and now it's video games, and it's going to be the video games in the future. But there's nothing specific about games being used in, let's say, election campaigns or for communicating a particular message. But on the other hand, we are confronted with this fracture in perspective, because the popularity of video games is accompanied by a certain stigma, which still is associated with the games industry, or even with the activity of play. The fact that games are there to be enjoyed, the fact that they are there to be consumed, means that play itself, or video games, is a frivolous domain. And people like me and Constance and some others from the audience who study video games academically sometimes are confronted with the need to justify the study of what is often objects of entertainment and pleasure. But that's not the only way, of course, in which we can think about video games. Because it's not just state agencies and presidential campaigns that use video games. The beauty of them and the great advantage of the games industry is its wild variety. We are far beyond the moment where there were a handful of video games and only a particular type of people played them. The video games industry is now characterized by enormous diversity, which makes it particularly suitable for different purposes. I'm going to play a little video now, and we're going to continue the debate on a slightly different theme. I'm going to ask Rob to talk about how the type of industry that he works in enlisted the power of video games. And why video games, and what are the challenges of using this very powerful form to communicate the message that you want to communicate?
Thank you. Actually, we should have given you a health warning before we showed you that video. It's pretty strong. It's based on the testimonies of children who came to war child centres in Lebanon after the first year of the war in Syria. So none of what you saw is a fictionalised account. It's reenacted in Croydon, but it's what really happened to a child in our programme. So if you want to address one of our problems with democracy, which in this country is that people are quite apathetic. They will see stuff on the news, but they will rarely think that they have the power to do anything about it. If you want to reach people who aren't yet engaged in the struggle against that kind of violence, then you really go and find them where they are. And an awful lot of people, not just young people, but older people as well, are playing video games. And they're often playing video games which are violent. We wanted to reach that audience, and we wanted to reach them with a message that says, even though conflict is entertaining, in the real world, conflict actually creates a huge amount of damage, but there are things that you can do about that if you get involved as an activist and you put pressure on countries to stop bombing and targeting children. So this video has been seen by an awful lot of people. A lot of them have signed up to petitions. A lot of them have become war child supporters. But it came out of a little bit of history that we've had with the video games industry. We started in a very safe way with Football Manager, which no one can accuse of being violent or inappropriate in any way. And the guy who runs Sports Interactive, Miles Jacobson, has been a supporter of war child almost since we started. So for 8 years, we've received a royalty from sales of Football Manager. But we were then approached by a game called World of Tanks. And as soon as the fundraising team said to me, World of Tanks would like to sponsor War Child, I instantly said, that's a little bit tricky. If you're a charity that is actually involved in helping children in the conflict zone. But I met with World of Tanks, and the moment they said that at any one time there could be up to 27 million people playing World of Tanks online, it suddenly became really obvious that that is a massive audience. They're interested in conflict, and they're seeing conflict through the eyes of a tank commander, but they should be interested in the realities of conflict as well as the game-playing version of conflict. And it was absolutely true. We've had a great partnership with World of Tanks. And working on this campaign, I think, enables a charity to be in that part of the gaming world without facing the criticism that we are selling our soul in order to fundraise. We're actually taking our soul and we're putting it right in the middle of the gaming community. And I think other charities are beginning to see that they can't just avoid this massive part of human experience. They have to be quite brave about stepping in there. We think it's really important. We've hired a guy called Wayne, who's in the audience. As far as I know, Wayne's the first person from the games industry who's been recruited by a charity to help them to reach that enormous market of people who play games. And we've just published our own bundle of games, raising money for War Child. But we're working on a much bigger project called Armistice, where we're hoping that lots of studios will agree that for a certain moment on a certain day, yet to be announced, games players will be able to buy in-game content which turns their game into an armistice zone for a certain period of time. And they may well enjoy playing football with the opposition, as the people in the First World War did on Christmas Day. But the idea is that our audience is there. They are playing games. They're there for us to go and find. And we're not going to sit on the edge of the gaming world and complain that all our lovely people are suddenly too interested in gaming to interact with us. We're going to go and interact with them in the place where they are.
That's a brilliant example. There are other examples, like Amnesty trying to cooperate with Call of Duty, I think, on creating the mod, yeah, Call of Rescue, which is, again, partnership between two different kind of giants.
But Cliff,
you mentioned trying to donate money to charity, but would you find it difficult to integrate that kind of content in the game that you're, the games that you're producing or publishing, because your company also publishes games made by other people?
Well, it can be difficult because the game that I'm known for is kind of very very blatantly doesn't take a position on it. It's trying to kind of just say, here's politics and economics, and you can play with it. So it's not trying to say giving the children machine guns and heroin is bad, even though it's leaving all moral judgment out of it. And that's deliberate to allow people to kind of like imprint their own opinions and play about their own opinions and not be judgmental. And I think it could potentially be quite difficult, because if there's a danger that you're kind of preaching, a lot of people will be turned off your game, I think. Or I would worry about that. I would worry that I was being seen as trying to lecture people. And because what I'm selling is a commercial game, the understanding is that you're providing fun. And yeah, you're providing hopefully sort of more than that as well. But the idea that here's a game about politics and also the designer is going to tell you what to think, even if it's a fairly uncontroversial point of view, I think that does get tricky.
How did that happen in World of Tanks? How was the message for War Child integrated? Was it just ads during games, or was it a part of gameplay? How was this this dilemma?
Well, if you clicked on, there was an in-game purchase that you could click on in aid of War Child, and then you would be shown the video, and then you'd be allowed to continue to buy the click-on. But also on the Wargaming main page, there are clicks through to the campaign. So we didn't interrupt the game to show them the video, but the video was, there were lots of different ways where if you were logging on to World of Tanks, you could have access to that content.
It was integrated in the activity of clicking.
Yeah.
But also, that's a very uncontroversial thing. I mean, I can't imagine anyone saying, Well, no, I'm in favour of children suffering during war, and you know, I don't want you to preach at me.
Yeah.
So you can do it with that. The only danger there is someone says, "Well, I just wanted to blow stuff up. I'm not here to care about that." You know.
Yeah.
For example, if you took a different point of view, if you took a point of view that, for example, we need gun control and put that in a game, that's a can of worms in various countries.
Yeah.
Or you were pro-life, or pro, you know, woman's right to choose, whatever all the acronyms are these days. Points of view like that are very difficult. Whereas you have I can't imagine anyone criticising what you do. So it's easy. Yeah, there's always some maniac, but you know what I mean. People don't mind being interrupted for a good cause, but if it's slightly controversial, that's another area.
There's another example. There's a game called This War of Mine by 11-Bit Studios, which is about the experience of civilians in a conflict zone. And they worked with us from a very early stage in the game's development. And we saw that as a brilliant way to enable people to understand what it's actually like to be in a town where you basically have to hide all day and go out at night and find your food. And that's a lot more subtle. And there are some gameplay elements in that game which are intensely violent. But we felt that if anyone from the Daily Mail was to criticise us, we would say the most important point here is that you have to understand that civilians in a conflict zone are forced to do desperate things, but they are generally driven by the need to protect their children. And if you want to get refugee policy right, you have to understand that's the major driver, the major decision maker for civilians is protecting themselves and their kids.
What I was going to raise here is the sort of interesting difference between the US and the UK around the way in which games platforms can be used to reach people in order to politically motivate them for one issue or another. So in the United States, as in the UK, as of the last year, there is individual voter registration. And so the games industry in the United States goes out there and encourages people to register to vote, doesn't say who you should vote for, but regularly surveys people who play games on a range of issues. So if you went to the ESA website, you'd find out they've done surveys on, like, do you think America's too unequal, or should there be more action on climate change, or a range of things. And the reason for that, and Constance, you know, we'll be able to add to this, is obviously games are in a different political context in the United States around maybe some of the culture wars. But here in the UK, we haven't quite gone that far. I mean, I can say this now because I'm no longer working for the trade body, but it was quite an interesting discussion with the games industry talking about, to the same companies in the UK, saying, should we do voter registration around the European referendum? And there's a bit of a challenge within the industry, I think, between, with some companies, mainly those who do free-to-play products, where they're very, very invested in the brand and the relationship with the person who plays the game, that they feel that entering into the political space is something that might challenge that relationship or challenge the brand, which is about enjoyment, entertainment. You know, it could well be about social purpose, but there's a feeling that perhaps this is too political, which I think is interesting considering what happens in the United States.
I would say that the whole, you know, the rock the vote movement and the movement to have the video game industry through ESA, which is its trade organization, sort of get people voting. You know, it's also a political, let me back up. It's a smart strategy because in the States, we have to have this conversation about violence over and over again, despite the overwhelming lack of any good evidence. And we have very conservative politicians who, the moment you say games, want to say, oh God, let's regulate this. Let's regulate it, right? We finally had a Supreme Court ruling in 2011 that games actually contain statements about the world and therefore can't be, they actually are protected by free speech. But because of that, the industry engaging with trying to register gamers as voters is also a strategic move because it's it's the way in which, you know, I talk, we go and we do like congressional caucuses, and it's helpful to remind them, gamers are in your voting block. Gamers are voting. So lest you continue, well, I'm going to use this in my terms, this isn't ESA's terms, but lest you continue acting as though, I mean, continue with the same old stereotypes that simply are factually not true, it's helpful to be able to remind politicians and policymakers that game players are now, I mean, the average age is in your 30s, right? Games are no longer, games are casual games. Everyone is playing games. The idea of sort of treating the media as though entertainment's dirty and games are just nothing but Trojan horses for misogyny and violence, like those claims are not factually based, and to continue trying to build policy and public rhetoric around it, it's simply smart industry behavior on our end. I mean, we're absolutely lunatics when it comes to games. In case you haven't noticed, we're lunatics on several areas in the States in terms of public dialogue.
But here, the discussion, I mean, I found, again, like this 5 years, like 10 years ago, there was quite a big debate with about violent games. Actually, the big proponent of, like, ban it was Keith Bass, of all people. He was quite influential, Home Affairs Select Committee, and, you know, to watch out what he was... You know, looking at. So we were talking earlier today about the launch of Hatred, and I remember having this on my grid. You know, so, you know, it's pretty violent. It was gratuitously violent and random. And we had that on a grid saying, okay, well, some politician's going to kick up about this. And the interesting thing is that they didn't. And I feel that that's slightly gone off the boil in terms of, like, the political debate. I think the new generation of politicians, younger ones, people who get all the things you just said, Constance, you know, that they get, you know, that games are, you know, can be an art form, that people play them in their 30s, that it's not just a sort of, you know, kid in a room somewhere. And so I think that's moved on. But, you know, that's sort of touch wood, I suppose.
So, if the first question, this is a view of video games as just a technical vehicle in a political campaign, hearing. Second question told us that video games are messages in themselves, and they're also particularly good at giving voice to those who are usually not heard, or making us aware of those voices. But the final comments bring us to a different relation, kind of relationship, or a different dimension of the relationship between video games and democracy. And I'm going to read you something right now. Democracy, says here, on the best business card ever known to mankind, cannot succeed unless those who express their choice are prepared to choose wisely. The real safeguard of democracy, therefore, is education. These are the words of Franklin D. Roosevelt, and are found on the back of the business card of Harris, of Positive Games, and the designer of Democracy. So this is how we come to a different kind of relationship that has already been hinted at, which is games as educational platforms, but not only as, you know, serious games, as in games designed for education, but games that can teach us something. Games that tell us something about the world without intending to lecture, without intending to, you know, take us through the ABC of either politics or morality. And Cliff already talked a little bit about his games, but let's watch another brief media clip and see how games talk about democracy and whether there is a space in the contemporary political sphere or social sphere use games as vehicle for education, for talking, for expressing particular views about what democracy really is about. First of all, it's a brilliant game. You should all play it. We'll love the plug. but also, it's a game that talks about democracy. We have heard democracy being presented as not just democracy the game, but democracy, the process. And it's a game that talks about democracy while, as Cliff already mentioned, trying to be a politically neutral game, a game that doesn't teach you what you should want, It doesn't try to steer your choices. But whether that's possible or not, well, this is what this section of the debate is designed to uncover. So Cliff, first of all, why of all kind of potential strategy games, why this one? Why a game about democracy? What kind of gave you the idea? Where did you find inspiration?
God. Yeah, you won't like the answer because it seems so random. I was reading a book about a game developer who had gone on from making games to trying to make an artificial chimpanzee, and he used to make the Creatures games. Steve Grand, I think his name is. And so he was into robotics and like neuroscience. And anyway, so that's the sort of book I read. And I was reading this book, and he talked about neural networks and basically how our brains work and how you would code that. I'm a programmer generally. And in some like random thing happened, and I thought, hey, you could model politics and economics like that. And I reckon I could code that. And I come from quite a political family, and I studied economics at the London School of Economics. So it was kind of like, it was what I was interested in. And as a game designer, I think the best way of coming up with game designs is to like look at the real world and look around you and sort of think, that's kind of a game. You know, I can make that into a game and I can make that interesting. And I thought that the way economics and politics was kind of interrelated. It just occurred to me that it's all part of a game, really. There's a lot of trade-offs, and it's basically a case of trying to keep lots of plates spinning, which is a very old sort of metaphor now, but of like trying to keep lots of things working and trading things off against each other. That's basically the way politics works, and to some extent the way economics works. So, you know, there was already a game there, really. I just had to kind of code it and kind of hope that it would be fun. And it turned out it was an absolute nightmare to design because there was no game like it. So there was no kind of like format for it. But it turns out that gamers are really interested in this. And for quite a long time, I assumed that I was selling the game to kind of people my age or older. And I had this image of kind of like semi-retired lawyers buying it, because you know I'd worked for big games companies, and you know we were sort of, you know, making the normal kinds of games, and I just knew that like if you pitched it to someone, if you said to like a publisher, we're going to do a game, and the mechanics are basically going to be income tax and interest rates and credit ratings agencies, what do you think? Everyone would say nobody would possibly buy that. So I assumed it was selling to a kind of like really weird little group of people. But then when we did the third version and started showing it at game shows, we found that just there were loads of kids. There was just everyone playing it. So you'd have kids that would be playing the latest shoot 'em up and talking about that. And then they'd come over to my game, which I thought would be ignored. And then they'd all sit in a huddle around it, and they'd like argue about income tax rates, right. Which it was brilliant, and I was so surprised because I thought I would be like this sad guy in the corner with a game full of like spreadsheets that everyone would just stare at and go, well, why did he come? But it turns out that like gamers are a lot more politically aware than you think, and they're a lot you know, and they're looking for complexity, and they're looking for something interesting that kind of matters, and also for something different, because you know, I've been playing games since they started, and I've rescued loads of princesses and fought dragons and blown up loads of planets, but I haven't set income tax policy that often. So it's just a new thing. It's a new thing, and it's an interesting thing, and you know, it's surprisingly popular, I guess.
Well, at the risk of kind of undermining your market. this is not the only game, of course, that talks about democracy. And I'm sure that a lot of us know that in all the games that we have played, there is politics in the background. Sometimes this background is more pronounced, like, you know, if you played Bioshock, you know, it's a game that happens in a particular political context. Or if you've played Republique, which again, it's not a game about politics, it's a stealth game, but it happens in a particular system, a totalitarian total surveillance state. So even though that game doesn't teach us about the mechanics of democracy, or doesn't present us with the workings of democracy, we still have some idea from playing that game that a totalitarian state would work kind of like that. But you were talking this morning about how people approach the modding opportunity game, and that they were trying to bring in new elements, which is where I think the educational aspect, as in not what you were trying to teach the players, but actually what the players were learning without you wanting to teach them, which is of course the best form of teaching when you don't even try. But what were the best stories, the funny stories, and what were the challenges? Because you had this mission to keep the game politically neutral, but at the same time you brought in an expansion, I think, which called the Age of Extremism.
Yeah,
it's not exactly a politically neutral extremism.
Well, it is. Obviously nothing is neutral, but with the original game, people wanted, they wanted more, and they wanted to take more extreme positions. So I did actually try to do what I thought was like politically neutral extremism, which sounds impossible. But in other words, it was an expansion where you could do a lot of extreme things. And the thing about the game is it never judges you at any point. It doesn't even sort of say you've done a good thing or a bad thing. So you get achievements in the game for all kinds of things. One of them, I can't remember, it's like a religious state or something. If everyone in the country becomes religious, you get an achievement for that. But the word achievement in there, it just means you've done a thing. It's not like a good thing. Because there's also like a Darwin Award for if you completely eradicate religion. And there's a Banana Republic Award if you just destroy all industry except agriculture, get heavily in debt, and you have a lot of trade. And people will play to get that. And it's a deliberate thing in the game that I'm not trying to say this is how you should run a country, necessarily. But what was quite funny was that when I did extremism, I put in stuff that obviously this is nuts. So I took extreme points of view to the right wing and to the left wing, and I put in extreme environmentalist policies and extreme religious policies. And that was 2 years ago, roughly 2 years ago. But since then, politics become so extreme that my extremism expansion isn't extreme enough. It is kind of funny because, when I was trying to come up with extreme policies, just the one that really sticks out to me is the whole, to solve immigration, which, it can be an issue in the game, and to just build a wall and stop people coming in. It didn't occur to me, and not even taking any sort of value judgment one way or the other on the sanity of the policy. It's just that would kind of be ridiculous. So politics has kind of caught up to some extent, and a lot of the real craziness, some of the accusations that we've had in sort of UK Parliament about various stuff, and even when I did an electioneering thing for things that can go wrong, it was so timid. So, the idea that you'd sit on a train, for example, and say there were no seats, but actually everyone films there are seats, I wouldn't have even thought of that. And or the whole kind of Mao's little red book being thrown at another politician and stuff like this. It was just outside the whole realm of it. So I feel a bit like Amando Iannucci being outdone by real life.
Anybody want to come in on what we can learn from video games? I still have to bring that up, your achievement. Highest ranked politician in World of Warcraft.
Oh, that story, yeah.
Yes. What have you learned?
Well, I'll tell you this very brief story in about, I can't remember, it's on the register. So if you Google Theo Blackwell, highest ranked World of Warcraft, there's a bit of a discussion about this. But there's a senator in Maine, or I think they're called a senator, I mean, not a senator to Congress, but a local senator who'd been attacked by the Republicans during an election campaign because she was a lowly level 68 orc assassin. And they'd gone into like what she'd said online. And she was obviously playing in character and sort of saying, oh, I'm going to stab you and all this stuff. And then they used it, the Republicans used it against her, saying you were completely unfit for office. So whilst this was playing itself out, I'd been quite hooked on World of Warcraft for a while. And I had an undead wizard warlock or something like that called Plague Pit. So that was the highest level that you could get, 85 at the time. So I decided that the time was right for the mythical world of Azeroth to be claimed by the Labour Party. So so I said, I reckon I'm the highest ranked politician in the UK on the World of Warcraft, to see what would come out, you know, see if like, you know, George Osborne would emerge or something. And I didn't really get any challenge, but it's like a different culture in gaming, because the debate in America was mostly, I think, almost all about whether it was appropriate for a public representative to be playing games and to be acting in character. Whereas, I wouldn't say entirely, but most of the debate about me doing it here in the UK was that I had really, really crap gear and I wasn't a very good player. And even though I said I suck at PvP, but you know, it didn't really make any difference, because they were just like, oh, you can't have that intellect armor there, and if you know the score on that. So it was quite an interesting sort of difference in approach, because gamers were saying that I was rubbish in the UK, whereas in America there was like more of a social debate about whether politicians should be doing this in the first place.
There's, of course, many other, and I'm sure that all of you will have your own examples of cases where we learn about democracy. One of the famous cases is EVE Online, of course, which is a player game, where, of course, there's no democracy in the game, but there is democracy outside the game, the management, where the players actually elect their representatives, who then negotiate with the game making company as in what are their requirements, what are their needs, how the game should be run. And I myself, I'm studying EVE Online to understand how different forms of community are emerging online, and how understandings of politics, and especially international politics, violence and war and diplomacy, are being circulated in all these different media. But enough of us. So I'll open now to the floor, and I hope we'll have plenty of time for questions, and I hope there's going to be a million of them. I would be grateful if you, A, keep your question a question rather than a statement, B, keep your question short, and C, it has to be three, tell us who you're, if anybody, you're directing the question to. The question could be for the entire panel or for one of the. Okay, so.
Thank you very much. My name is Yari Krivoy. I teach law at the University of West London. Interesting observation that the world of tanks actually comes from Belarus, not the most democratic country in the world. When I teach law, I'm always thinking that it would be good to use games. However, it's very expensive to produce games. What can I do as a law teacher to produce games? Are there any funds, or is there any very simple software which I can use to do that? Thank you.
Did you mean games for teaching? Anybody has any clue about that?
Yeah, well, okay, I suppose I do. It depends what you mean. Some people, you can make games really cheap, like massively cheap. If I make a game, it costs about £100,000. That's to really polish it. That's a commercial game you can sell. The difficult bit is finding the people to make it. That is the problem. And you can make a game for less than that. In terms of getting funding for doing that, that's a whole nother that's a whole other ball game, really. But I, you know, there is a big kind of market there to kind of make games in this area that actually make money. I mean, I used to keep very quiet about, you know, how well Democracy 3 did until it becomes public knowledge now, because Steam Spy tells everyone what everyone sells, so everybody knows. But there's a commercial argument to make political games. You can do it and you can make money if you know what you're doing. It doesn't have to be a kind of philanthropic thing. It doesn't have to be an educational thing. You can actually do this as a commercial endeavor and at the same time make something that is educational. So, for example, Democracy 3 is used in loads of schools. We sell licenses to schools and universities all over the world. But that's just a sort of side effect of already having a game that people think is educational. And I think that is the way to do it, because if you start off thinking, how can I educate people about this? Oh, let's use a game. Gamers can spot it like from orbit. You know, it's kind of good for them, and they don't want that. What they want is something that's entertaining, and then they will happen to learn about stuff, and that tends to work better. I mean, I got very interested in the sort of history of World War II through playing Call of Duty, which sounds ridiculous, but, you know, it did a good job of, like, giving you a bit of history in with entertainment, and I think that is the primary way to do it.
Oh, thank you. Hi, I'm Anita Williams from War Child. Thank you so much to the panelists for all of your interactions thus far. I was really interested to know about, you mentioned that gaming actually brings about behavior change. And I was just thinking about where is the evidence on that? It'd be really interesting to see what evidence there is both in the US and the UK on that, and what sort of learnings actually that we could pick up for our interactions with the gaming industry at War Child. Thank you.
Yeah, there's more than a decade of research. It depends on domain, right? So there are games for health, particularly around not just teaching content knowledge, but actually changing lifestyle. So there are sort of gamified systems that increase activity or decrease calorie intake, et cetera, et cetera. There are games, I know the work on games and learning best because that's been a domain I'm involved with. And there what you find, depending on how you ask the question, like Glass Lab did a massive study and showed, I think it was 12% gain over traditional materials, which means more than a grade in the States, using, you know, games versus traditional material in a classroom. Comparatively, that's what you get. What that actually means, of course, like what were the materials? Like that's a whole nother methodological question. But the idea that games can affect behavior change is pretty much across all the disciplines I've looked at, whether it's, you know, the big findings are language acquisition, literacy, science reasoning. I see less on math, but probably because there are fewer math games out, to be honest. Just a bevy of behaviors, casual games used to reduce depression. All that said, you know, I think it's probably really important to remember that, so, you know, in the work that I do, you think about games as kind of this intervention, but the truth is that games really are sort of this expressive medium. So games about democracy are this sort of object to discuss. They're this thing to interpret and discuss. They're not like a dosage effect where I come over and I inject you with, you know, a particular medication or something and then study the outputs. And that can make research complicated. I don't think it makes it complicated. I think it makes it valuable. But it means that we have to be careful about how we sort of position them. You know, one of the delights, you were talking earlier, so all the game designers I know, the moment that players do crazy things with their games, they get really excited. It's like a brag thing that, so I think you brought up like some of the crazy stuff players will do with your game, right? And the reason it's so exciting is because games are an art form, right? It's that you wrote a book and people did something fantastic with it. Something that wasn't predicted. And so sometimes the biggest impact points are not necessarily the effect sizes. But if you want the effect sizes, the research is there. There's like four different meta-analyses. I'm happy to share them later.
I'm intrigued by the demographics of modding, because although I know that kind of loads of different sorts of people play games, they're often different sorts of games, and I think the people who tend to mod tend to be more male, and I'm wondering if itself is whether that has an effect. I noticed that your image for democracy was very much white man's centre and forward.
Oh, and man, I get that so much. And I can defend it.
But if you do, you do. But I'm just curious about... Politics is largely male as well. Is that just the way it's going to be, I suppose? That it's... a particular sort of people who are doing those particular sort of games, whether for good or ill.
This brings us to the question we were discussing this morning, whether there's a duty to make games in a particular way that breaks from reality. So we may say that games are, this is the reality, but is there a duty, both from game designers and game users and academics and journalists and so on? So I think that kind of speaks to a much bigger question, but you have some questions to ask to answer.
It's all my fault.
You're supposed to fix it.
It's very difficult to handle these sorts of things. For example, the reason that that's a man's voice in that is that out of the actors chosen, they had the best voice. And like the next game that we did, Big Pharma, the main character was a woman because she was a better actor than the other people. And we didn't even tell people whether or not to pick a man or a woman. But it can be very difficult, that. For example, art costs money. And to like huge companies, it kind of doesn't matter. But every time you have like a character in a game, you can only have so many. And it does become a very difficult issue. We did a version of democracy that was set entirely in Africa, about African politics, which completely bombed. It hasn't even made its money back yet. And we kind of got a lot of grief about that in terms of choosing the characters that we represent, which was very difficult because it was basically two middle-class white English guys doing a game about Africa, which is... already impossible to kind of not have your biases in there and all the rest of it. But we found that there was just kind of like no defense. Whoever you picked to like put in an advert or whatever, it would be you are misrepresenting Africa, or you are misrepresenting women, or you are misrepresenting... there was always some problem there. And the problem is that you just don't have enough kind of space to get the message across. It's very difficult to do that. And I completely accept that as an individual making a game on a political topic, it's going to be biased. Like Democracy 3 is definitely biased. I know that intuitively, but I can't tell you in exactly what directions because I'm biased. So like it's for other people to I guess point that out. But one of the beauties of modding is if you think it is really biased, you can change it. So for example, we have an equation in there that says if you legalize guns and let 12-year-olds have rocket launchers, will crime go up or down? And that's a value judgment. I think crime will go up if we did that. But that is a value judgment that is in there, and loads of people in the States would disagree, and it is very easy for them to change that. And another problem that we had actually is we use the word liberal in the game, and because I'm British, I take liberal to mean Nick Clegg, and not in a bad way. I mean, he's a liberal. But of course, in the United States, liberal means something else, and they have kind of more of a like libertarian thing. We never talk about libertarians here. So that whole kind of like terminology is controversial to even do that. So it's a huge problem to do a game in this area. You will always be criticized, and I've tried to make it neutral, but I know it isn't, and I know we've got stuff wrong.
I like the question, and we're really talking about how games reflect back our own society and how they can therefore shape our society in a good way or a bad way. But I think about the issue from the point of view of a 12-year-old boy in Baghdad, say, I mean, games are a cultural output. If you want to learn about Western culture, you might think that looking at the kind of games we play will tell you a lot about our culture. But if you're in Baghdad and you're seeing Europeans playing games which are quite violent, and sometimes the bad guys are look suspiciously like your neighbours, that's not the only thing you're being told about the West, though. You're also being told by ISIS or some other kind of radical group that the West is a violent place, and the West has decided that Islam is there to be destroyed. And the proper response for you as a 12-year-old is to start to learn the Quran and become involved in jihadi politics. I think it's a very, very dangerous mix. And across the Middle East, there are almost 500 million children in countries affected by conflict who will choose by the age of 15 whether they believe what they're being told about the West or whether they think actually the values that we have that underpin our societies are better than the values being offered to them by radical Islam or any other kind of group who wants to recruit young people for whatever goal they've decided they're chasing. And I don't think there's been that much debate about what kind of image the West is presenting to this massive population of people who will go one way or the other.
I think relating to that, in terms of if you think about a child in Baghdad and them looking at games and sort of, you know, taking a message from it, although when we did our game about Africa, it was a complete flop and commercially and critically, nothing. I am quite proud of the fact that we did do a game that, like, very briefly was on the front page of Steam that had a cast of characters who are all from Africa, and we did our research and checked that our ethnic minority there, statistically speaking, would be Chinese, and everyone assumed it wasn't until we looked into it. And we got a lot of abuse, I have to say, primarily from Americans, saying, is this a joke game? Because there's no democracy in Africa. And it was actually quite shocking. Yes, there was a lot of that. And I think if all I've achieved, even if the game is bad or it has its own internal biases and we've got stuff wrong, if, you know, all we've achieved is there is a game about economics and politics in Africa, about African citizens, and, you know, to be blunt, we made a game with black faces in that were not terrorists or kind of drug smugglers. And it was set in Africa, and that wasn't where the baddies hang out. And believe it or not, I think we're the only game, the only like mainstream commercial game that did that. And that in itself, I think, is quite shocking. So it's kind of like baby steps in that direction, yeah. I guess.
I want to ask the question that to me is implicit in the title of the panel, and that's the relationship between video games and democracy right now. And I'm taking it as a given that video games are part of our culture, whether we actively play them or have just had some contact. We've all somehow absorbed this to some degree. And in many ways that's good. It can be an effective vehicle for education. It can be a way of teaching people things through entertainment, through ways that activate their imagination in interesting ways. And I also think it's very problematic, these kind of 1990s debates about violence in video games. I think, 99.9% of people are perfectly able to differentiate video game violence from real violence. If they aren't, that's a completely separate thing. But my question is whether, video games are about making choices, most of them, and they are teaching us certain ways of analyzing structured situations and making choices about those situations. That's what democracy is about as well. So my question is whether video games now, as part of the way we experience the world, whether any of you know of research or have your own speculations, and this is for the whole panel, whether this is changing the way democracy is playing out. And I'm obviously asking this in the context of a US election that is going in directions that nobody ever thought possible 6 months ago.
Yeah.
Should we start off? I mean, if you want to make a comment about the US.
Yeah, that's a good question.
Yeah, exactly.
Go!
Go.
Concepts. It's just. If games have a it's obviously not me. Writer. So the evidence on learning, right? So, I mean, games are vehicles for ideologies and verbs. I think the question you're asking is a really deep one, which is not even necessarily, if I understand you correctly, not even necessarily about overt representations of democracy in games, but instead, games are these complex systems, and games are built to be gamed, to find the holes in them. We fail as a way for the system to reveal ourselves. One reason that games are so focused on failure is that failure needs to be interesting, and we fail as a way for the system to show us what it's got. And the idea of gaming a system is really deep, right? Coming up with a novel way to flout the conventions of the game is considered very high status. And I don't know of any research on that. I mean, I do know some really early stuff in corporate America that looked at things like got game and what gamers were like in the workplace. And a lot of that at the time, I felt as a researcher, I was like, this isn't even based on much research. But I think the question stands about the ways in which you have this ethos of approaching complexity and approaching systems, thinking that the way that it's laudable to not play, laudable to screw the system, right? I mean, I wonder, it's an interesting research question. I don't know any data on it, but I think there's something there that's really compelling. I do know that, I teach games, I teach methods courses, I do social sciences, I talk to it, and I study a lot of gamers, and you see a lot of complex forms of problem solving, but not all of them are necessarily complex forms of problem solving that treat the means of getting to the ends as important as the ends. Because in a game, you don't have to. But is anyone doing research on this question? We ought to be asking that question. I will say, if we're looking for why American politics right now are so crazy, that's an overdetermined problem, right? There are too many variables going into that output. And games are not on the top 30 things I'd worry about. And the same holds for people's incredible self-absorption and incredible, I guess I would say, cynicism about government and civic participation, period. I don't know that games are the big variable I worry about, but I don't know that they're helping either.
Okay, so I'm interested in whether games spread democracy or not. And if you look at all the countries in the world where there is democracy, a democracy that actually has worked over a period of 20 or 30 years, think about countries where you might live where there's an income, the average income is less than $1,000 per person per year. You're very unlikely to be living in a democracy. In fact, only 20% of countries in that bracket of income are democratic. The biggest one being India, which is incredibly democratic for the income it's got. If your income per head per year is over $1,000, you will probably be living in a democracy. 90% of countries at that income bracket live in democracies. And so between $1,000 and $11,000, you have a gradual increase. I think what you get when you're in a wealthy country is you get access to education and access to ideas. And in the old system before the internet, ideas came through literacy and through access to TV, radio, and books, things that you acquire when you have a reasonable level of income. And yet, the Arab Spring happened in countries where the average income per head is below $11,000. And the Arab Spring, I think, was important because it shows me that the internet and the social media within it and the games within it are reducing the price level at which you begin to think about whether your government is actually the one that you want or not, and whether you're in a system that you'd like to change. So games which demonstrate democracy or struggle or the oppressed overcoming the oppressor, I think can be very inspiring to people, and has led to a lot of democratic energy in countries that traditionally just aren't wealthy enough to sustain a democratic process. So I think games have a real part to play, which is why I worry so much about what games are telling people. Mm. Democracy is an amazing game for people in Tunisia who want to overthrow a dictator. I wish there were more games like it.
You blaming me for...
No, no, you didn't make the problem, but you're the one who's going to fix it.
The Arab Spring.
We're not blaming you for Donald Trump.
We were talking earlier on today about just more generally about games and how, I mean, I'm just a boring town hall politician, but, you know, if I know Fallout 4 is post-apocalyptic, but, you know, there's this kind of trope of the mayor as this kind of, you know, 1930s corrupt mafioso. I think he's a zombie as well, but it's like, you know, but there's this kind of thing of like whenever you see local government in a game, it's usually in the kind of Chicago 1930s setting. It doesn't, you know, it's not like a public servant who has to make decisions about the future of an area. And obviously you've got simulators like SimCity and Civilization, all sorts of other things that go on which do it in a slightly different way, and of course Democracy 3, but you know, so I think there's an issue around how politics is presented, as there is in film and other genres. An interesting sort of experiment that happened, and not a very successful one, in participatory democracy was the use of budget simulations, which are very, very lightly, I suppose, one could call a game, in English local government after 2010, because we had massive cuts coming through the austerity programme. Very, very briefly, local government has a lot of money from central government. That's being cut, but at the same time, you're required to do all sorts of services by law, like look after vulnerable children and older people in the mainstay, and also lots and lots of things that people want you to do, like keep the library open and the streets clean and fund some extra police and all sorts of other things. So, you know, quite a big set of challenges there when you've got a large chunk of money going out. So a lot of councils invested in budget simulators with the hope, I think, you know, politicians facing these big budget choices, that the public would tell them which services they wanted to cut and which ones they wanted to save. But of course, as with anything, the public didn't actually give them a very clear view. So they were back to square one. But what I think they did do was explain perhaps the complexity of the decision that the representative has to make. And during this period, I'm not saying games were a major factor in this, but it's interesting that the satisfaction rates of local government actually went up from 2010 to 2015 because more was being talked about the kinds of services that you got for your council tax and your general taxation. So even though the primary objective, in a sense, was a politician saying, or a set of politicians saying, as representatives, please make the decisions for us, fundamentally, it's one of these things that allowed complexity to be told. And that, I think, is quite an important thing for a politician, because decisions are trade-offs.
I think it's interesting that I'm sure a lot of people would say a game about the local council budget is the most boring thing imaginable. But it's funny that when you put something in a game, however boring it is, it's suddenly fascinating to a certain group of people. So, you know, there is a game called Street Sweeper Simulator, where you drive a truck to clean gutters. And that's a commercial game, you know, that's money. And it's funny because, like, when you gamify something, suddenly something that's really tedious is suddenly interesting. You can get people, I mean, I know this, you can get people interested in tax rates and interest rates and credit ratings agencies if you package it up nicely and you give them awards. And it doesn't surprise me at all to know that, like, you know, budget simulator things are kind of like popular and people like them. I think there should be more of that.
Can I ask you, I mean, do you think part of that might have been that not only does it reveal the complexity of that task, but also the feeling of maybe some transparency?
Yeah.
That they just said, here.
Mm. Yeah.
Good luck. Right?
I think at the same time, councils were struggling as well to present a very, very complex set of budgets which relied on all sorts of different levers, how much council tax you create, what your parking fines are, what your central government grant is for this, that and the other. And I think, and there was also a way, I mean, I think more successfully people were able to do things through presentation of how budgets worked, you know, as you see in the sort of graphics industry of, like, you know, ideograms and things like that, that you were trying to explain complexity. But I think, you know, a game is quite an interesting way of doing it. Fundamentally, I don't think it was successful because the games weren't very good, you know, yeah. And that, I think, you know, as with anything.
Thank you very much. This has all been fascinating. This question is mainly for Theo, but open to everyone. How did you go about, like, in your experience, convincing video game studios to become more politically involved?
Become more politically involved? I think you can convince studios to become more socially involved. I think the budget simulator in this case was very much something that was like a little, probably more off the shelf. You know, there are a couple of competing firms that would offer to do things. I think it's gamified rather than a game studio itself. In my experience, and I sort of defer to the judgment of colleagues on the panel, is that game studios are often they work really, really hard to get a product out the door, and then they shed half of their staff before the next thing comes along. And to try and get them to do things, it takes a different kind of approach. What we've tried to do in Camden, where we're like home to quite a large part of the games industry, is really link the studios with schools and show that the role of the state or the local state is on their side on a number of things. And games companies suffer from a massive lack of long-term talent. You know, that's in schools, we're not teaching kids how to code and yet, you know, it's early days on that. So finding some common interests with them was actually really important. And also we take MPs into studios as well, which is a real eye-opener, because you really do see how little MPs know about the latest technology, about what's going on. So we had Sir Keir Starmer, who's MP for this area, sort of going in and playing with the croc monster in Batman Arkham. And I mean, now the image of an MP with the 3D glasses on is kind of as ubiquitous as someone playing ping pong a couple of years ago, which is what MPs were always done. So I think immersion with MPs is really, really important, but very few people actually reach out and do that. That helps. So.
Yeah, I would say what our experience is that studios are really, really keen to help us raise money and mobilize people for causes like the one in the video. In fact, War Child's roots is in the music industry. When we started, we got the best bands in the world, in my opinion, into Abbey Road Studios for 3 days, and we had Radiohead and Blur, and they did an amazing compilation album. In the days when people bought CDs, it raised a lot of money in a very short space of time. So we've just done the same with 11 game studios who have created games which are available on a compilation called the Help compilation. And, well, Wayne ran the project, but in general, we found the studios were really, really keen to do it, because studios are populated by human beings who have a work life and a home life and a broader life, which they understand through their impact on the community. So just like any company, studios, I think, want to find ways that their teams can get involved in something bigger than just what they're
just
working on.
Game, yeah.
And it seems to work pretty well. And, you know, generally, these people are less than 40 and they have the energy do things like that too.
I have a question about rule of law. The biggest source of crisis in today's democracy in many places is the weakening of the rule of law. When you look at this whole literature on democratic backsliding, it is often about the problems that people do not understand the rule of law. So the question is simple. Are there any games that allow people to learn about law and the significance of law in a democratic system?
Felix,
In the States, there's Sandra Day O'Connor's iCivics curriculum. I think there's like maybe one game on law there, but I think it's more about argumentation. But I think the answer is no. I can't think, of course, there's got to be an example somewhere that's going to prove me wrong, but I can't think of a single title in the impact space, indie space, or AAA. Can you?
I can't think of one. In democracy, you get to appoint judges, don't you?
You get to set the law, so you can outlaw stuff, and you can, legalize stuff, and you can do whatever you like. But the assumption is that people obey the law.
Yeah, which shows you it's fundamental to democracy. It's so fundamental that you can't have a game called democracy unless everyone assumes that what you decide as the boss of the country will actually happen, and the rights of individuals not to be taxed too much will be protected by...
Well, on those lines, there is modelling in Democracy 3 that, for example, if taxes are too high, you get more tax evasion. So there is a kind of like... And things like that. So there is kind of like an implied you have to take the people with you when you set the law. I kind of assume that if you change the law, people tend to go that direction, but maybe not at the extreme. So I guess that message is kind of subtly in there that you can change the law and therefore change society, but if you push it too far, things will go wrong. And also you can be assassinated in Democracy 3. If you outlaw, loads of people are and they complain about it a lot. But they're normally doing something absolutely nuts and really quickly. So like if the first day Obama was in office, he outlawed guns. That's what people try and do in Democracy 3, and they're very rapidly assassinated for it. and then they complain about that. But you say, what you did was nuts. What you have to do is you have to like sort of wean people off that mindset so that you can change the law with the consent of the people. So that's kind of like an implied thing in the game, I think, that you can only rule with the kind of agreement of the people.
I think there's far more games that talk about the absence of the rule of law, because that's where the transgression happens.
Yeah.
And this is where possibility spaces are explored by players. But as Constance was saying before, we shouldn't take those to be causally relevant. I mean, the fact that we play Grand Theft Auto, where the rule of law breaks down whenever you're kind of in character, and you get to do lots of things outside the law, doesn't necessarily mean that that's an education for how to be a criminal. Nor does it mean that people who play the game have a secret desire to be. But I think most players are very capable of distinguishing between the moral spaces of the game and their lives. But speaking of which, this is how I give the floor to the panel for the final very brief comment on how to take forward, how to make this relationship work better. What would be necessary? What should change from the point of view of the game designer, the academic, the activist, or the politician? And we can think already of elements of the game industry, for example, Apple's ban on apps that are explicitly political. That's clearly something that interferes with a democratic process because it removes voices that otherwise would gain exposure. And we were talking this morning about Constance's work at the White House being driven by the paramount question, what kind of games get made and what kind of games don't get made. Right. So if you had the power, what would you change? How would you see this relationship work better? So whoever wants to start. A brief statement for goodbye. Not quite a statement.
And then they can vote for who's got the best idea. democratic kind of way. Yeah, yeah.
We can gamify this, yes.
Yeah. Can I go first? I am very struck by the fact that video games tell stories and they put you in a context and you absorb ideas which are influenced by who you're shooting at and where they're standing and why you understand yourself to be in that position. And most of the narratives, well, all of them come from the game designers, who are generally not the people that I work with. I work with children and young people in conflict situations, in refugee camps, or in military groups in the Central African Republic. I would be really interested in a project that allowed those people to design their narratives and create games, which I'm sure would be just as much fun as our games, but would allow the player to understand what it's like to game daily life in a refugee camp in Jordan, where you have to work in all kinds of different ways to take the aid that's given you by the UN and turn it into all the other things you need. In order to be a happy and successful 15-year-old teenager growing up in a refugee camp. I have no idea what games they would design, but I think they would be fascinating, and I would love to work with some studios that would come out to, say, Zaatari Camp in Jordan and run some game design workshops with those young people. I think it would be amazing.
If I can just say a couple of words... I think that, I mean, there's sort of two aspects of this. If I was going to be pessimistic, I'd say that games, despite major advances, are still seen by people in government and in town halls. I'm sort of, you know, I'm relatively sort of weird in the sense that I'm not 60, you know, helping to run a town hall. But, you know, the kind of average age of people in local government is more pushing that. And there'll be a lot of challenge about whether we should spend public money engaging with people in that way, and they'll question whether it works or whether it's just aimed at kids or young people. And then there'll be the challenge that, well, young people don't vote anyway. I mean, it's a bit of a circular argument, but we've still got to get over that and over some of the resistance and the inertia that comes from the people who advise the elected politicians as well, who often are a little bit closer to the budget strings in reality. Having said that, there is a very, very significant moment in UK and US politics where government is becoming much better at mastering the data of the world around it and budgeting better and doing more innovative things and doing what's called open call democracy, actually describing what a problem is and inviting in answers from people outside. And there are also, obviously, we've got great excitement at the moment with some people in politics who are saying, well, we should have more participatory democracy and budgeting, which is a moment where some new things could be experimented with. So with more data, government can be more responsive. We could have experiments with reward systems of, if not a game, but game-like features within how the citizen relates to the state and how the state responds back. So the future, you know, could be a mixture of these positive and negative things, but I do think that it actually has some really exciting opportunities that arise from that.
I think a lot of good would be done if you get everyone from the House of Commons spend like 20 minutes playing a game. And that's not just because, you know, I like games. I just think that we can be a little bit too harsh on politicians and like old people, as it were, because they have this view of games and it's out of date. Because kind of we all do that. I mean, when I was a kid at school, in like, you know, English literature, I'm sure I was forced to read poetry and I hated it. And I haven't gone back to see if poetry's got any better since. Why bother? And games are a new medium and they're the only significant new medium really in that sort of area. And there's a massive difference between Pong and what we have now. But if you're a politician with a lot on your plate and you don't have time to look into everything, you probably think you know what video games are about because you played Space Invaders or you read the thing on Pokemon Go. And obviously there's a lot more to it than that. And politicians need to be shown that. But I think we can be a little bit too harsh on them for not knowing about it. You know, we don't, any of us know much about, you know, sanitation policy in the sort of urban environment, and they have to learn all this nonsense, and they have to leave something out, and they've left out games. And, you know, we just have to drag them into a room and make them play something.
I have a laundry list. There's a lot of things I meant. I really want a much more thriving game scene where we have games that are horrifying and violent and terrible, and games that are funny and silly and frivolous, and games that are documentaries, and games that are sad stories, and games that are romances. I think we're getting there. I think we're hitting a golden age, at least in the States, of games. But there's a lot out there that, in terms of its expressive medium, that we haven't even done yet in games, and I think that's a possibility I would love to see happen. I would love to see the conversation around games continue to improve. 13 years ago, I was told that I would ruin my career studying games. And they were wrong, right? And I'm glad they were wrong, but I think we have a long way to go. I think games journalism has a lot to improve. Mostly, I think at the root of it, I think that at least in America, we have this nasty puritanical streak. We denigrate play, we denigrate games, anything that's frivolous, anything that's fun and pleasurable. If you say the word pleasure on a panel in America, people kind of flinch at you like, oh, you just did something naughty, or I don't know. And it's true. I mean, I think there's this general sort of denigrating of play. Like, everyone has become so constantly hyper-performing, hyper-productivity, and yet if you look at the development, the intellectual cognitive development of our species and of our mammals that we study, in fact, all mammals that we know of, even some non-mammals, play is the fundamental way that we come to understand our world. It's where most novel solutions come from, play. That is a fundamental fact of the species, and yet you say that and people are like, oh, games, now you've got to justify it with a whole bunch of science talk, which I can do. That's great. I can tell you about the studies, and I can tell you about how. But, you know, I was saying earlier, like, play is always the thing. Entertainment and play are always the thing that escapes the mere functional role that games can have in democracy. And Dewey and others made great arguments about the role of leisure in democracy, the role of play and creative enjoyment. And I think it's gross that as adults, and I can say this in my 40s, I think it's gross that we allow ourselves to sort of fall prey to this rhetoric that says that, you know, all culture has to be boring opera, and that what we do for entertainment is guilty pleasure. And rather than sort of saying that happiness and playfulness ought to be a fundamental fact of everyone's existence, and we allow it as children, and yet we don't model it as adults. So I know that sounds weird. Just saying it, I said the word pleasure. Did you guys flinch? What does that mean? Does that mean that you did not flinch, or that you did? You did not. I can never judge.
He wants to say it again.
Pleasure.
We're all there.
Yeah, I don't know how to move the needle on that, but.
Okay, so gamification, gaming camps for the diversity and pleasure. That's the way forward. Okay, so once again, thank you for being here, and please join me giving a huge round of applause to our excellent, excellent panel. Thank you.